you know? But how'd you get into that?
I came out of political science, and I was hoping to work for the government, and I did for a little while. Terrible.
Not good?
Yeah, no. And anyway, I'm tired of getting into those endless conversations with friends about this way.
I mean, normally you get a sequel for a big blockbuster, something that made a lot of money, and Before Sunrise didn't make that much money, but I think that it affected people so much. I mean, the people that really liked it really loved it and see it again and again and again, and the same with the actors and the director, is that they're so passionate about it. I think that's why we're given the opportunity to make this sequel.
Yeah, okay, from a Western point of view, things are getting a bit better.
A great feeling when I think of Before Sunrise. It's been 9 years since we shot that. It's a kind of a gift to be able to go back and revisit characters like that, because they sort of, any movie you do, they sort of keep existing in your mind. You know, but especially these two, they just always kind of kept growing. So my relation to that movie, just like the events of this movie, is like kind of forever changing.
Doing the first film, we were talking about that with Ethan the other day. It felt like something was unfinished because they never meet again and because it ends on this kind of open ending. It was such a wonderful experience to be writing all together and to bring so much to characters.
The dream of doing this other movie started when we were doing the first one, that Rick kind of, when they had the idea, wouldn't it be interesting to meet these characters again in a slew of years and to maybe do 3 or 4 or 5 films, you know, kind of. And then you'd have this kind of giant document on love and on relationships following two actors through the course of their life.
When they came to make the film, they had 3 weeks of rehearsal, and they worked really intensively with Ethan and Julie.
I'm just curious, is this a, when she comes over here, are we trying to maintain a single?
It's a two-shot.
It's a two-shot, so I can get as close.
Ethan and Julie brought a lot of themselves personally to the work. A lot of their own ideas and stories ended up finding their way into the film, and so when the three of them decided to make the second one, they just wanted to all come to it as writers.
This movie, it's been fun to, what I'll say is like carve out something of real time, you know, like some kind of hyper reality, you know, of trying to make sense of the world in a movie way, of just how people live or think or interact.
I've got 15 more minutes. Do you have a cell phone?
Yeah.
All right. Well, look, I got that driver guy's number, and I can call him, and then they can pick us up at whatever the next stop is.
You know what? I've never been on those boats. It's for tourists. I didn't want my character to be too close to who I am. I wanted her to be somehow, it was like, almost like when I was a little girl, I wanted to do politics and to be in political science and everything. That was my dream. And I didn't go that route because I became an actress really young, and I enjoyed it, and I don't regret any of it. But to be able to become in a film what you always dreamed to be.
I want to know about you. Tell me, what are you doing, you know? What are you up to?
Where to start? I work for Green Cross. It's an environmental organization.
Yeah, what are they all about?
Well, we basically work on different environment issues, from clean water to disarmament.
A movie like this is only as good as how much of ourselves we put into it, I think. It's just a little thing. It's not,
nobody will notice if we don't do it, but it's a good thing if we do.
What I like about the first film is that it's got so much of all of us in it. You know, I mean, it's really, Rick is really the guiding force behind it all. You know, these characters are his conceit and situation. But what makes the movie special is, you know, just trying to be honest about where we all are in our lives and our thinking, and create characters that are hypocritical and, hypocritical in the way that real people are, that you say one thing and you say another thing and you're trying to figure it out, you know, how so many things can be true all at one time.
I mean, I think the world might be getting better because people like you are educated and speaking out. Even the very notion of conservation.
We talked about it for years, but then we realized that we really had to do it. We all, for about a year, exchanged emails writing different scenes, and Rick would say, try to write on this subject, try to write on that subject. And then one day, Julie busted out 40 pages of dialogue, and that got us going. And then Rick took that and met with me in New York and met with Julie here and then in Paris. And then we all got together once for a weekend in Paris. We've all kind of felt pregnant with the idea for a while.
I'm serious. I think I wrote it in a way to try to find you.
Yeah, that's not true, but sweet for you to say.
Sometimes you spend a lot of time in rehearsal just talking to the actors, like kind of defining, getting on the same page about who their character is, what they would do, what they wouldn't. I mean, that was not even a consideration. And the fact that the three of us together worked on the script, so most of our rehearsal was just kind of continuing to work on the script. And we still are. I mean, it's sort of doing a segue between their character. It's rarely that I remind Julie or Ethan, like, oh, well, I think Julie would do that, but Celine might be a little, I mean, it's very rare. I mean, they both have such a clear idea of their character. It's scary. I mean, it kind of, this is like, I'm not so much, I don't know, it's almost directing in a less traditional sense. Just the fact that we're all working together, again, there's no anxiety. Often when you're working with someone the first time, it's like, do they think I'm doing a good job? Is this working? Is it, you know, like, we've chosen to be here, so it's not, there's no question of whether we should be here or if we're right for the part, or, you know, so like we're all, I feel like the three of us are really making this film together.
Rick brought me to all the, when they were doing sets, you know, looking for the sets, you know, he was like, do you think that would be your apartment? I was like, yeah. Or I was like, no, not at all. Or like the stairway, I was like, that's the perfect stairway. You know, that's where Celine would live.
We knew that we just accepted this challenge. We're gonna make this movie in 15 days. And then we had to, you know, kind of like a puzzle, just try to put it all together. But I mean, generally in a typical Hollywood film, you have to plan things much more than that. You know, we had to sort of be planning for things not to be planned, to be able to change things quickly and adapt as we went along.
Okay, back to the corner.
So this one we've bitten off a lot. While we have few locations, and kind of longer scenes and fewer locations, that's easy, but that's easier. You know, I've done films where we had 81 locations and we have 55 days to shoot it, so that's a lot of company moves and it's a road movie. It's very difficult. This movie, we have not that many locations, maybe 9 or 10, but we have a couple weeks to shoot it in, and we have to match sort of the light. It's taking place more or less in real time in a later afternoon, so we really can't shoot in midday. If the sun's overhead, it just doesn't really match anything else in the movie. So we have to be getting ready, and then we have these short windows where we can shoot, and yet we have 6 pages of dialogue to get. So it makes it very difficult, but the fact that we're even on schedule or we're able to do it is, the whole film is sort of based around the fact that I thought Ethan and Julie could just show up and really nail the performances in a pretty short amount of time.
The other day we were filming a scene in the car and they could just pick up and, you know, 8-minute scene, go all the way through from start to finish without one stop missing a beat or anything. I think that's extraordinary.
When we start shooting, we just, okay, now we're actors, we've got to learn those lines we wrote. We're like, shit, why did I write this? I have to say all of this now? Oh my God, this is hell. I've got to learn this, like, one-page monologue. No!
And this second one has been even more intense. You know, we only had a little over 2 weeks of rehearsal, and we're shooting it in 3 weeks, and it feels like this one's a sprint. We've been meditating on this one for a long time, though, so.
Merci, au revoir.
Merci. Let's go shopping.
No, that's a bad idea. I don't want to inflict that on you. Let's go up to that garden path. It's really nice. It's a.
She can't get the line.
She can't get it right. I say thanks.
Thanks for what?
It's probably one of the hardest acting jobs between Before Sunrise and this one that I've done in a way, because somehow to place someone very natural, that it feels like it's conversation, that, you know, we just met in a cafe and talked. That's what the film has to feel like. To play a character that's very real and that could be your friend or your neighbor or something like that is much harder in a way, because you have less gimmicky things. It's more based on reality and it's very fragile. It's very subtle.
You know? The three of us all have such different personalities. Sometimes the collaboration can just kind of take off.
And Julie and Ethan have both directed films and written pretty extensively. I mean, I have collaborators here who are filmmakers, so it's like the three of us making this film.